Hello everyone, I am Dr. Ipshita Ghosh, your faculty for endodontics. Today we will discuss some direct question. So first question is, the greatest success in indirect pulp capping techniques occur in number A, attruded teeth, point B, extensive caries teeth, point C, young patients, point D, young patients with diminished pulp vascularity. First of all, you have to understand the question clearly. What is the question? The greatest success in indirect pulp capping technique occurs in? Definitely the answer is young patient. In case of extensive caries teeth, attruded teeth and young patient with diminished pulp vascularity, there is less chance of success. In young patient where there is no diminished pulp vascularity, there is higher chance of success. It's very simple and easy question. No need to give too much effort to understand this. Then second question, which of the following are true about direct pulp capping? Which of the following are true about direct pulp capping? Point A, mechanically exposed teeth have greater success rate than caries exposure. Point B, final restorative materials do not affect success. Point C, generally individual teeth involved in a fixed prosthesis are candidates for direct pulp capping. Point D, all of the above. Which is the right answer? If you discuss the point A, if we expose the tooth mechanically or with caries, it's all the same. Though if we pass more time, even if the tooth is exposed mechanically, there will be chances of bacteria presence. So it's all the same. So the answer A will not be the correct answer. Then B, final restorative materials do not affect success. Yeah, in case of direct pulp capping, the final restorative material doesn't affect directly. Okay, we can take this point. Okay, let's see the other points. Point C, generally individual teeth having involved in a fixed prosthesis are candidates for direct pulp capping. No, this point C is actually not related to this part. Then as A and C is obsolete, A and C we are not taking, the generally the D is not the answer. So what is the answer? Answer B. So which of the following are true about direct pulp capping? Answer is final restorative material do not affect success. Okay, I hope it's clear. Then the next question, the success or failure of direct pulp capping depends on quality and amount of blood flow. Yes, this is right, because in case of less blood flow, the success rate will be less. History of previous pain is also one of the factor. We have to know the history. Then C, point C, age of the patient. Yes, this is also very important. In case of young patient, there will be in case of young patient, there will be more blood flow in the tooth, because there will be less, the blood supply inside the tooth will be more rather than if you compare with the aged patient. So yes, we can take the point C also. So the answer will be all of the above. The success or failure of direct pulp capping depends on number one, quality and amount of blood flow, number two, history of previous pain, number three, age of patient. So answer is all of the above. Then next question, a technique which utilizes calcium hydroxide as liner placed on thin layer of questionable remaining dentin is termed as? You all know the answer. Answer is indirect pulp capping. In case of direct pulp capping, there will be no thin layer left behind. Though the question is written thin layer of questionable remaining dentin, still there is chance of remaining dentin. So we'll give the answer of indirect pulp capping. Vitality test, compaction technique doesn't arise in this question, because compaction technique is different technique for filling the cavity. Then vitality test will see the whether the tooth is vital or non-vital. And direct pulp capping, as I have already told, it will be directly over the pulp. So answer is naturally indirect pulp capping. So a technique which utilizes calcium hydroxide liner placed on the layer of questionable remaining dentin is termed as indirect pulp capping. The next question, which of the following is best barrier between a restorative and pulp? Option A, zinc phosphate. Option B, calcium hydroxide liner. Option C, sound dentin. Option D, varnish. So answer is sound dentin, because it's natural. Okay, whichever is more natural, you have to, it will be more acceptable. So sound dentin is the answer. So which of the following is best barrier between a restorative material and pulp? Answer is sound dentin. You don't have to see other option also. The next question, a material when applied to the prepared tooth surface is solvent quickly evaporates, leaving a thin film of resinous material is, actually its answer is varnish. So the from the definition of the varnish, sorry there is some spelling mistake. Through the definition of the varnish only we can say that the answer is varnish. Okay, so answer is point C. The next question, cavity varnishes are film forming solution possessing, it is not actually thermal insulating, it doesn't have, varnish doesn't have thermal insulating quality. So the point A is not right. Yes, it is it has semi permeable quality. I'll tell one important point. If you get the right answer in the first one or in the second one, don't skip the other questions. I mean other options. The other options might be your answer. So don't be overconfident. So you have to read the third point. Third point is C, the quality of not resisting micro leakage. No, this is also not correct. So we will not take the answer. So as because this two is cross, so all of the above is not also answer. What is the answer? Semi-permeable quality. Remember, this varnish have semi-permeable qualities. Okay. Then next question. All of the following are characteristics of calcium hydroxide except. Point A, it acts, let me read the options first. It acts as direct and indirect pulp capping agent. As we all know, it is, calcium hydroxide is mainly used for indirect pulp capping, not for direct. I have discussed in previous questions. So it is for indirect pulp capping, calcium hydroxide. So option A is not correct. It acts as a protective chemical barrier beneath filled and unfilled resin. No, this is also not correct. We cannot put calcium hydroxide beneath resin, because it will dissolve. Calcium hydroxide will dissolve. Then point C, it acts as obtunent. Yes, you can take this answer. Calcium hydroxide can be used as obtunent. Then point B, its resinous solution acts as a cavity liner. No, this calcium hydroxide doesn't have such property. So option is, it acts as obtunent. This is the right answer. So calcium hydroxide acts as obtunent. The next question, sharp pulpal pain disappearing on removal of the stimulus is frequently a sign of, definitely reversible pulpitis. In case of reversible pulpitis, if you remove the cause, then there will be no pain. But in case of irreversible pulpitis, what happens? Even if you remove the cause, the pain will be persistent for some time, or maybe long time. Okay, so option A we cannot take. In case of reversible pulpitis, this we have seen that if you remove the causative factor, then the pain will disappear. Acute pulpitis, there will be continuous pain for some time. Then chronic pulpitis, this pain is not reversible. So option is reversible pulpitis. In case of reversible pulpitis only, if you remove the causative factor, then the pain will subside. Next question. Cracked tooth syndrome is characterized by, as we all know, during diagnosis what we see, In case of cracked tooth syndrome, we used to let the patient bite with something in a hard, like in the handle of the mirror. Then we see if there is pain. Then we become definite that there is cracked tooth. So answer is, let me read the points. Point A, sharp pain following application of cold. Then point B, sharp pain following application of heat. Then point C, severe pain while eating. Then point D, all of them were mentioned. Okay, let me discuss point A. Sharp pain following application of cold is doesn't definitely say that it's a cracked tooth syndrome. Similarly, not even heat. But yes, in case of severe pain while eating, these two bite things, as I have mentioned, while diagnosis only, we used to let the patient bite in a handle of the mirror and we used to identify. Here the point is similar to that. So yes, we can take this point, severe pain while eating. So the answer is point A, C, sorry. Point C, all of the above mentioned is not correct. This is also not correct and this is also not correct. Answer is severe pain while eating. Then the other question, next question. Tooth feels elongated and sensitive to percussion in cracked tooth syndrome, as I have mentioned in our previous question, is to let the patient bite, then only there will be pain. So this answer is not correct. Then reversible pulpitis, it might not feel sensitive while percussion. Then irreversible pulpitis, yes, irreversible pulpitis, yes, you can take this, because in case of irreversible pulpitis, there will be sensitive to percussion. And answer D, it cannot be none of them. So the answer is C. I think this point is very clear. 14. If a fractured tooth is non-restorable, it should be C. If it is not restorable, then definitely we should extract it. We cannot reimplant, we cannot splint two anterior teeth, or we cannot provide interim restoration. Directly we will go to extraction. The question of restoration comes if it is restorable only. So answer is extraction. So if a fractured tooth is non-restorable, it should be extracted. Very clear. The next question. Vital intruded tooth usually erupts by itself after a period of, should remember this point, 6 months. Okay. Answer is 6 months. Not 1 month, not 2 months, not 3 months, 4 months. Answer is directly 6 months. You just remember this. If a tooth is vital and it is intruded inside the oral cavity, then it should be come out. It should come out within 6 months. Next question. Electric pulp testers will not normally respond in case of fractured tooth involving pulp after duration of 2 days. No. After 2 days also, there will be false positive, false negative answer. Then result. Then yes, after 1 month, we used to let the patient come after 1 month. So answer is 1 month only. Not 3 months, not 6 months. Okay. 6 months is too long time. 3 months is also too long time. So answer is 1 month. I think you remember we always used to ask patient after any road traffic accident or like that. We used to ask the patient come after 1 month. We'll check again. So answer is 1 month. Very simple answer and very simple question also. The next question. Calcium hydroxide is used as a pulp capping agent because point A, provides good thermal insulation. No, calcium hydroxide is not a good thermal insulator. So, answer is not A. Then provides a mild irritant action on pulp. Yes, this is the answer, because this calcium hydroxide, if it irritates pulp, then there will be more blood flow, which will lead to healing. So answer is this. It provides a mild irritant. Severe irritant, what will it cause? Severe irritant, it will cause the pulp to death. In case of mild irritant, there will be more chances of healing. Okay, let me discuss the point C also. Provides a soothing action on pulp. As already we know that calcium hydroxide is mild irritant. It has no soothing action on pulp. So answer all of the above is also not correct. So answer is B. It provides mild irritant action on pulp. Next question. In a tooth with no caries, fine occlusion and no sensitivity to percussion, and in whom pain is brought about only by biting on something or release of pressure, the probable diagnosis is without seeing option, we can say it's a cracked tooth syndrome. Isn't it? Because during the diagnosis only, we used to let the patient bite the handle of the mirror. I have discussed it earlier. So we don't have to see any other option. We are overconfident that the answer is C, cracked tooth syndrome. Okay? So let's not discuss the other point because this is a very clear cut question. Next question. There is greater potential for thermal sensitivity to option A, gold casting, option B, amalgam restoration, option C, composite restoration, option D, silicate restoration. As we all know, gold is passes heat more faster than any other material, as because it's a noble metal. So gold casting is the answer. Gold is a noble metal. Okay, so this is the answer. Silver also noble metal, which amalgam has, but it's comes next to gold. So answer is gold casting. Not composite restoration, not silicate restoration. So there is a greater potential for thermal sensitivity to gold casting. Next question. The material placed into deep cavities with suggestible reversible pulpitis is? Point A, zinc oxide eugenol. Point B, glass ionomer. Point C, calcium hydroxide. Point D, zinc phosphate. As we all know, zinc oxide eugenol has a sedative effect on pulp. Okay. Thus, it has also mild irritant effect on pulp, and which will lead to healing of the inflammatory process or stop of the inflammatory process into up to some extent. So answer is, in case of reversible pulpitis, we used to place zinc oxide eugenol in the deep cavity. Not glass ionomer, not calcium hydroxide, not zinc phosphate. Answer is zinc oxide eugenol.